colleagues. My name is Dr. Çiğdem Mumcu. I'm a neurosurgeon in Turkey. Today, I'm going to talk about biportal endoscopic technique, some useful tips. To start with, I'll say to 2013, UB surgery is extended from simple discectomy to treatment of stenosis and even fusion surgery. Let's move on talk about the advantages of UBE. The merit of UBE is more familiar to spine surgeons. UBE and microsurgery are almost the same approach in terms of instruments, anatomy, and surgical results. UBE view is a clearer and safer. UBE provides a good visualization of contralateral, subluminal, and foraminal areas. And it has a wide range of indications. We can use all surgical instruments without any limitations. Furthermore, it is more beneficial for the patients. Let's watch these videos. The video on the left is UBE discectomy and the one on the right is microscopic discectomy. UBE view is much clearer and it also has more blood-free vision. That means clean view makes the surgery easier and safer. And here are the disadvantages. UBE is a great endoscopic procedure, but it is technically difficult. Especially neurosurgeons might not be familiar with arthroscopic equipment. So the surgeons need to be trained to specifically learn the manual skills. UBE surgery has a long learning curve. To do UBE surgery, you should have 0 or 30 degree endoscope, RF device, shaver system, irrigating system, and special UBE instruments. UBE has a wide range of indications. All kind of degenerative spine disease, such as herniated disc, spinal stenosis, fusion surgery, revision surgery, facetsis, and so on, can be treated by UBE. For the moment, we cannot operate intradural pathologies and spinal infection by UBE. However, in the near future, we expect to achieve this. When you start UBE, we recommend you operate with easy discectomy cases at the level L5-S1, which has interlaminar window that is much wider as it gives you much maneuverability. Later on, start with discectomy on the level of L4-5. By practicing more, then you can do it lateral recess decompression. And when you get more practice with using bird drill, you can start a spinal canal stenosis. Then finally, you can perform with posterior foraminotomy in the cervical spine or far lateral discectomy. You will gain enough experience in your first 50 cases. Yeah, okay. Now I will talk about some tips of UBE surgery. First of all, operative preparing is very important for patient safety. We should perform UBE under general anesthesia. It is better for both the patient and the surgeon. The patient must be in prone position with a neutral rolling bed. Also, 5 to 10 degree head up position is necessary to protect optimum ISP during the surgery. Wilson frame allows kyphotic posture, which would increase epidural pressure and lead to more epidural bleeding. We recommend you not to use it. The next issue is about your team. Your team is very important as well. There are lots of details to prepare before starting the UBE. That means your nurses need to know how to set up the water pump or the irrigation system, how to connect your video system, and so on. It is not only the surgeon who must be trained with the manual skills, but also your team, your nurses, your technical staff for the final success. The next issue I would like to focus on is the technique. And here you can see the operative steps. First one is skin marking, which is the basis of for UBE. There are two portals. One is the working portal, the other is the scope portal. These two portals must create a triangle above the lamina, which is very crucial. Second step is to create working space. For this, we clear upper lamina, interlaminar space, and lower lamina of soft tissue with the dilator. The next one is the irrigating system. It is essential to know how to use the irrigating system for fluid control, clear view, and bleeding control for patient safety. When you prepare the interlaminar space, the following step is similar to open microdiscectomy or microdecompression. This video shows us preparing the skin portal. For Paramedian approach, first we need to determine the midline, then the second line should be drawn on the medial margin of upper pedicle. Third line should be in the disc level. These lines should form a triangle in the center of spinous process. Distance of two portals is about 2 to 3 centimeters. After the skin and fascia incisions, the two dilators are inserted through the lamina, and then the dilators meet and create a triangle onto the upper lamina. Then muscle detachment is made by the dilator on the distal margin of the lamina and medial side of the facet joint before inserting in the endoscope. It is necessary to prepare enough visual space. At the end, the scope and RF probe are inserted through the incisions, then are created V-shaped. At the end, the scope and RF probe are inserted through the incision, then are created V-shaped working mode on the upper lamina. Finally, a potential space is made with RF. So triangulation is crucial. If you make good triangulation, you can see the instrument in the screen. If you don't, that makes the surgery difficult. Irrigating system applies water flow continuously, so to control inflow and outflow is crucial. We should keep the pressure 30 to 50 millimeter mercury for patient safety. Controlled continuous outflow can make an optimal hydrostatic pressure. If outflow isn't proper, epidural pressure will increase and lead to some CNS complications. A good outflow gets clear view. Moreover, we can check the bleeding. If you lose anatomic orientation, the procedure becomes risky. We always need to know exactly where we are. We need to know, to have full orientation. If you feel you are getting lost, you should convert to microsurgery. High hydrostatic pressure can cause CNS problems such as headache, posterior neck pain, seizure, blindness due to retinal bleeding, hydrocephalus, and pneumocephalus. RF ablation may cause thermal injury on muscles and cord as well. It does especially protein denaturation at between 40 to 70 Celsius. That is why RF device must be used for a short period. If you cause more muscular damage by RF, it can lead to muscle edema than infection. If you want to get a good result, outflow should be continuous. At the same time, your surgical view should be clear. The scopic hand can be moved in all directions. If you go deeper and closer to the pathology, you can reach a clear vision. That is very important. To keep optimum ISP, 30 and 50 millimeter mercury, first, patient should be in the head-up position. Second, we always have to control the outflow. For this, the nurse holds the UBE retractor. Continuous output prevents complication. To prevent IF damage, you can relatively touch on dura of lumbar spine, but on cervical spine, don't. You should avoid touching directly on dura of cord level. Use IF for a short time and repeatedly. Let's talk about how we can control bleeding. Epidural vein usually bleeds. If there is bleeding, you should move the scope much deeper. Also, you can insert the suction tip here like a natural drain. Then fluid and blood will exit. Or you can coagulate directly with RF. If it doesn't work, you can use bone wax, gel foam, and so on. If you don't know where the focus of bleeding is, close the irrigation and wait for just 2 or 3 minutes. Clotting will happen spontaneously, then you can restart. In this slide, you can see my UBE cases that I performed for 2.5 years. In the beginning, I faced serious complications such as bilateral visual loss, epidural hematoma, and so on. I've learned how to avoid complications gradually. Now I will explain some vital details for a safe surgery. Now we will move on to talk some of my cases. This case was my first UBE case. He was 28 years old and had a right leg pain due to L5-S1 disc herniation. I performed UBE 2.5 years ago. There was no dural injury or any complication during the surgery. Postoperative, a few hours later, bilateral visual loss was observed. He was immediately referred to the Department of Ophthalmology. He had bilateral retinal hemorrhages. In this slide, you can see his fundus photograph of optic disc. He was applied a YAG laser in both eyes. 1 month later, his visual acuity increased and the hemorrhages remarkably recovered. My second case is 34-year-old woman. She had left leg pain for 3 months due to L4-5 disc herniation. Preoperative MRI shows the ruptured disc at L4-5. This is another section, her MRI. After the UBE surgery, right side surgery, a ruptured disc was totally removed. There was no dural injury or any complication during the surgery. Postoperative MRI showed good decompression of the spinal canal, but she developed right foot drop after the surgery because of excessive L5 nerve retraction on the right side. She undertook physical therapy for a couple of months, and then she completely recovered 6 months later. Here you can see her intraoperative video. The surgeon should always be gentle with the dissection and handling of neural tissue in such cases. Third case is a 21-year-old man with severe left leg pain, which had lasted for 7 months. A preoperative MRI shows the ruptured disc at L5. After UBE discectomy, ruptured disc was removed. This intraoperative endoscopic video shows ruptured disc compressed left L5 nerve root. Fourth case, a 29-year-old man presented with severe pain in both legs with claudication. Preoperative MRI images show the severe spinal stenosis with herniated lumbar disc at L4, L5 level. After UBE surgery, central canal is fully decompressed. Post-operative MRI was taken one day after the operation, showing the sufficient decompression of spinal canal and adequate resection of lumbar herniated disc. Here, this is the UBE stenosis surgery. Let's watch my last video about how to perform UBE. You can see that surgical view is much clearer during the operation. In conclusion, UBE technique gives a better and easier visualization of all directions. UBE may be an alternative and minimal invasive procedure for treatment of all degenerative lumbar disease. Thank you so much for your attention.